Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Springfield Indians Hockey. Tonight, the Indians taking on the Southern Division Baltimore Skipjacks in another key Southern Division battle for the Springfield Indians. Just 15 games remaining on the 1985-86 schedule, and the Springfield Indians gearing up for a tight playoff race down the stretch. My guest on our pregame show this evening is the general manager of the Springfield Indians, Bruce Land. Bruce, the Indians coming off a very successful Maritime swing, and the Indians now in third place in the Southern Division, but coming off a successful road trip.
It's funny, Mike, before we went up into the Maritimes, Coach Fred Creighton and one of the players, Scotty Housen, both said to me they thought that a road trip about that time of the year would be good for this team, give them a chance to get together again, because in this league, you play a lot of games where you go up and right back, and we had a chance to get up there, get the team together, and the team responded with 5 out of 6 points, and overall this year in the Maritimes, a tremendous successful season with going 5-2-2 in the Maritimes, and I can't ever remember, and I've been around Springfield a long time, a Springfield team going up the Maritimes and doing that well, so it was definitely a good place for us to pick up some points as we head down the final few games here.
What's happening with the Indians? There's all kinds of changes with the roster and injuries, always adding up for the Springfield Indians, and not any different on this Maritime trip.
Well, it's a bad time of year to get injuries, and we've had not a bad year as far as injuries are concerned in comparison to some of the other clubs, but we've been hit pretty hard now. Terry Martin, the latest casualty, of course, running into the goalpost in the game at Fredericton. He's got a bruised abdomen. He'll be out of the lineup tonight. Chris Pryor, unfortunately, they found a crack in his ankle. The second x-ray showed a crack. He's going to be out for about a minimum of 3 weeks. Gary Lacy, who was playing so very, very well, playing alongside Timmy Kulas, he's going to be out of the lineup for about 3 to 4 weeks with a shoulder problem, similar to what Scotty Housen had earlier in the season. And we get Dale Henry's going to try and play tonight. He's been nursing a hip pointer. A couple other guys, Mike Stans, who will not dress probably for the weekend. He's out with a badly bruised knee. So the injuries are mounting up, but the nice thing about it is we do have some depth, and we've carried extra guys this season, and now it's also a chance for some of the guys that perhaps didn't get as much ice time. This is a real key time for them to show what they're made of and really make a contribution to the team.
So Pryor and Lacy, basically the only two, as far as those are concerned, with long-term injuries.
As far as long-term, Tim Kulas is not playing also tonight because of an ankle injury. It's the same ankle that he had broken during training camp and had to have surgery on. He was going to see the doctor, and hopefully Timmy will be all right. But as far as long-term injuries, right now it looks like Gary Lacy and Chris Pryor.
Bruce, getting down to the stretch, and of course the conversation always revolves the top players in the American Hockey League, who's going to win the awards, and we're down to the last stretch of time. And who are some of your candidates for the MVP in the American Hockey League?
Well, first of all, you have to look at Paul Gardner. You know, he's sitting on top of the scoring again. He's a funny type of player. You know, he doesn't have blazing speed, doesn't have an overpowering shot. He's not physically strong, but he's always up on the top and scoring. He's going to break some records again in Rochester. As far as I'm concerned, he deserves a lot of credit. You have to look at him. You have to look at Darrell Evans, who was in Binghamton most of the season, as recently was recalled by Washington. Again, he's a big goal scorer. He plays the point in the power play. He's been a key player for Larry Flo in Binghamton. And I think also you have to look to St. Catharines. They've got a couple key guys there that, you know, have been up and down. They flip-flop players. Brad Smith was having an outstanding season up there. But you look around the American Hockey League, not only are there some good candidates for most valuable player, but there's also some good rookie performances out of guys like Donnie Biggs, who was here and went to Nova Scotia, and Adam Creighton before he got recalled from Rochester to Buffalo. So you've got a blend of some of the veteran players who perhaps might be your leading candidates for MVPs, but some of your rookie players have also done very well and are leading candidates in those categories.
How about early picks for best defenseman in the AHL?
That's so hard to say. You know, I seeing the teams in here, I spend more time probably watching our team and our performance than watching the other teams. But, you know, we have a couple guys right here who I really feel that deserve some honorable mention this year, if nothing else. I think Kenny Leiter's played very well for us this year. He's been in a solid groove. And you look around the league, there's some good defensemen on all teams. There's one or two defensemen that seem to be able to do the job. And I think it's a little early right now for me to even to speculate who I think could win that award.
It's always the toughest one. There's so many guys that you don't know whether to pick offense or defense, especially in the AHL. It's very tough. How about Coach of the Year? Any early picks?
Well, Terry Crisp has done a remarkable job in Moncton. You know, Moncton on paper do not have as strong a club as some of the other teams, and he's got them right in the thick of the race. Again, you have to look to... A friend of mine, Larry Plo, I think, has done a good job in Binghamton. He's been undermanned. They've been stripped with recalls and injuries. He's done a good job. You can always look at the first-place teams, Adirondack and Maine, who are battling in the north, and St. Catharines and Hershey. John Paddock also, Mike, taking that Hershey team into first place. And so there's a lot of candidates in that category, too. And Fred Creighton's done a good job here in Springfield.
So you're not going to go out on a limb anywhere. You're going to give the general picks, but you're not going to go out on a limb anywhere, huh?
You catch me last game of the season, I'll go out on a limb.
Okay, I'll do that. How about playoff for the Springfield Indians down the stretch here? How do you view the Indians' chances?
I like our chances very much. I think we've got a very strong defensive club, and I think it's been proven in the playoffs that if strong defensive teams usually do well. We've got great goaltending. Doesn't matter who we play, whether it's Taco, Casey, Sands, Hall, we've got good goaltending. Strong veteran defense and a team that can play a disciplined style on the road, which is very important. And when we get into the playoffs, as I said to you, I think on our last telecast, we're going to surprise some people.
Bruce Land, thank you very much.
Thanks, Mike.
General manager of the Springfield Indians, Bruce Landon, the Indians and the Baltimore Skipjacks, coming right up in just a moment.
These books guarantees you many rights. If you've been injured in any way through the negligence of others, a court of law may award you compensation. But in most situations, you need qualified legal counsel to protect your rights.
Call attorney Frank R. Sega today at 736-3611. Your initial consultation is free, and you pay no fee whatsoever unless and until compensation is awarded for your claim. So call now, 736-3611.
Cablevision Sports presents the Baltimore Skipjacks against the Springfield Indians. Good evening, everybody. I'm Mike Burrick alongside John Forsyth, and welcome to the Springfield Civic Center, where the Springfield Indians are coming off one of the most successful maritime swings in their history, taking 5 out of a possible 6 points and continuing their solid play in the Southern Division.
Boy, Mike, really a great trip for the Springfield Indians. A couple of games, they didn't do a lot of things right, and they still got a victory and a tie out of it. One game against Fredericton, outstanding. They still picked up a victory. That's the mark of a good club, and that's the way things have been going for Springfield.
Well, tonight, the Indians taking on a Southern Division rival, the Jacks in 7th place in the division, but always a tough squad, and led by a leader, 31-year-old Steve Carlson, who, of course, a former member of the Springfield Indians.
Steve Carlson, with 12 seasons of professional hockey under his belt, played just about everywhere you can play, Mike. The Eastern League, the World Hockey Association, of course, the American Hockey League, and the National Hockey League. There you see him right there. He wears the captain. Maybe he's not up atop the leaders as far as Baltimore's offensive attack, but one thing's for certain, he comes to play against the Springfield Indians.
He sure does, and if anybody remembers a couple of years ago, a force in the American Hockey League Summit Division playoff. Two guys for the Tribe have 5-game scoring streak. Both that were hot on the maritime swing. We'll take a look real quickly at Mark Hapshot and Mark Hamway. And there you see Mark Hapshot.
Mark Hapshot, after some midseason doldrums, has really straightened things out and has been on fire with a 5-game scoring streak. He's a player the Indians can count on for some point production night in and night out.
And of course, Mark Hamway. And we don't have that on our screen right away, but Mark Hamway scored a tying goal with 15 seconds left in the game against the Moncton Golden Flames, and the Indians ended up getting a tie. There you see Mark Hamway. Actually, that was in Halifax where he scored the tying goal. The Indians came up with the win. We'll get to more in just a moment, but let's pause for the playing of our national anthem. Great job by Francis Smith here at the Springfield Civic Center. Well, it's the Springfield Indians and the Baltimore Skipjacks, and this is the first time the Jacks have been seen on Continental Cable Vision, and a team in which the Indians always have trouble with here at the Springfield Civic Center. The starting netminders, there you see the Indian goaltender John Casey. Last year he played for Baltimore. This year he's gone 3-3-1 with a 4.21 goals against average as a member of the Indians, but played 22 games up with the parent Minnesota North Stars. The starting netminder for Baltimore is Dennis Herron, the 33-year-old veteran from Chambly, Quebec. 18 games, 10 wins, and 5 losses and 2 ties, as you see, a 3.04 goals against average. Spent 9 years with the Pittsburgh Penguins of the National Hockey League, including the start of this one. So we're underway as the Jacks immediately clear it into the Springfield zone. The Indians, who have currently a 3-game unbeaten streak, work out of their own zone, and Dave Jensen clears to center, bounces off the stick of veteran Greg Hotham in his own zone, who feeds on the near side. Jack's Phil Bork in his own zone. The Chelmsford, Massachusetts native, clears to the Indians' line, where Ed Lee shoots to the Jack into the rink, then it's shot right back to center and clear to the Jack line. Now into the neutral zone, tipped off the stick of veteran Gary Risling, and the Indians clear to center. Loose play in the neutral zone as the Jack's leading scorer, Tom Ralston, bursts down the right wing side, shoots right on. Casey hugs the post, and then it's blocked back behind the goal. We've played 44 seconds into this first period, a scoreless tie, as Dave Jensen scoops one to center ice, and into the center ice area, Paul Houck on left wing for Ed Lee. Dashes across the line and shoots. Herron, a pad save, and the bouncing puck taken on the near board by Tom Ralston, who outlets on the far side, then cleared right back in. Here's Ralston in his own zone. Leaves it for his own defense, and the Jacks. Ralston comes to center. Pass on left wing for Risling. Back for Ralston, but broken up by Craig Levy, who outlets on the left wing side. Now tip for Hamway on the near boards, but the whole play whistled down offside at the Baltimore blue line. The referee this evening, Andre Duhamel, the linesman Dave Butova, and Brian Collins.
Well, these two clubs have split both meetings here at the Springfield Civic Center. The Indians and the Jacks will meet twice more this year. The Jacks have a 2-1 lead over the Tribe as far as the season series is concerned, and the final two meetings of the year between the Indians and the Skipjacks will be in Baltimore.
The Jacks have 56 points and in last place in the Southern Division, but they're within 10 of the Tribe, so this is a very key, important game for Baltimore. As the Indians clear to the Jack line, then cleared right back to center, where Craig Levy outlets on the left wing side for Ken Leiter. Back to Craig Levy. He leads a rush to center and shoots one in. Back after it on the far boards is Chris Dahlquist, the rookie. He shoots to center ice, and the Indians take over. In his own zone is Craig Levy. Scoops it into the neutral zone, and Mark Habscheid takes control. We've played a minute and 50 seconds into the opening frame. A scoreless tie as Craig Levy spins back in his own zone as he works to center ice. Here's the offensive-minded Levy shooting one in. Goes off the glass back behind the net, and the Jacks take over, and Dean DeFazio takes control. Leads it back for his own defense, and Dahlquist feeds up the middle, but DeFazio takes a hit, then cleared to the neutral zone. Veteran Wally Weir on left wing feeds for Jim Magoo, who's checked off on the near side. The Jacks work it back for their own defense. Quick, fast-skating first period as the Jacks. Carlson feeds one through, cutting in, DeFazio scores! Actually, I think it may have been Magoo who walked in and put it behind the Indians' netminder, but nonetheless, the Jacks have taken a 1-0 lead. I couldn't tell if that was Magoo or the Jacks' DeFazio, but it is a 1-0 game.
Well, it's Jim Magoo right here, and you know, Jimmy Magoo has that great speed. We saw it a year ago with Binghamton, and here he is right here. It's just with a little bit of a hesitation move, he turned Indians defenseman Gord Paddock and was in free on John Casey as he shoveled it into the top corner. Jim Magoo gets credited for the goal here for Baltimore right off the bat, getting the Skipjacks off on the right foot. Magoo picks up his 11th goal of the year, putting the Jacks up by one.
Now Baltimore on the attack once more, and Cullen Chin, the rookie out of the University of Illinois Chicago, dumps it through, but the Indians able to take control on the near side. Baltimore leading 1-0 as the Indians come to center ice. Here's Paul Houck into the Baltimore zone, dumps it through, and taking over on the far boards for Baltimore is Dave Simpson. He's bumped off the puck, and then Carlson spins back in his own zone. Outlets on left wing for Cullen Chin. Bumped off the loose puck on the near side, and they finally freeze it on the near boards. The scoring play, Jim Magoo, from Steve Carlson at 249. Of course, Magoo playing, as John mentioned, for Binghamton a year ago.
Well, Jim Magoo acquired by Pittsburgh last season, and he, of course, a player with plenty of speed. We saw it last year, especially in the playoffs against the Springfield Indians. He was a force for the Binghamton Whalers. And tonight, Mike, you talked about Baltimore's stature in the Southern Division with 56 points. Tonight's game coming off a rough loss at home to Nova Scotia. They were blown out 6-1. They have to feel that this is their season here tonight, and they will be equal to the task, no question.
Play back behind the Indians. That is Ken Leiter. Outlets on the near side for Mark Hamway. Clears to the point, but shot in by Weir, deflected wide by Casey. Jammed up to the right point. Here's Dahlquist, unable to hold it in, and the Indians able to clear to center. Here are the Jacks in the neutral zone, taking control, wristing one of the Springfield line, but back the other way comes Habscheid. He's on an offensive tear and shoots right on. And Dennis Herron is able to make this stop and glove it and make the save.
Mark Habscheid creating a little bit of offense on his own there as he crossed the the Baltimore blue line right here. As you're going to see Habscheid come to center. He doesn't have any wingers with him, so the only thing he can do is just get it on net. You never know what's going to happen. And even though it's from long range, Dennis Herron right there dropping to his knees. The Indians, the last time they played Baltimore, Herron was in the goal in that game in Baltimore, and he was outstanding.
Faceoff coming up in the Baltimore zone for Baltimore, Tom O'Regan, another Massachusetts native. Now they throw O'Regan off the draw, and Habscheid wins it back to the point. Levy shoots one, he missed the net. Loose in front, Habscheid takes control. He tries to move through, spins to the far boards, tries to get away from Magoo, then jams on the far board for Ari Hanpa. Back to Habscheid, as it's still fought for over there, jostled back behind the net where Hamway controls. Works in front, shoots off the side of the net, and then it's finally frozen by Herron with all kinds of traffic in front of the Baltimore goal.
There you see Mark Hamway. He was trying to jam one in the short side right there. Herron held his ground. The defense right here for Baltimore has to do a better job of keeping the Indians away. You're going to see Hamway pick the puck up, and then he has a clear route to the net right here. Takes advantage of it, but the veteran Herron was there. Not fooled by it whatsoever. Ari Hanpa, who's been nursing a bad shoulder for the drive, comes in to stick his nose in. Good bid for Hamway as he took advantage of that clear route to the net.
Ron Handy for the drive. He's centering this line. He's been known to play both left wing and center this year. Playing center tonight as the Jacks clear into the Springfield zone, where Bill Stewart outlets on left wing. Here's Glenn Johannesson, tips it through to the Jack defense, but cleared by DeFazio. Then it's whistled out on an offside nonetheless on the near boards.
Well, speaking of injury, the Indians have their fill right now with the following players being out of action. Chris Pryor had some x-rays taken on his bad ankle. The bone is broken. He's in a cast right now. He'll be out for at least 3 weeks. Tim Poulos missing tonight's game. The ankle that he hurt originally in training camp has been acting up on him. Dale Henry still out with a hip pointer. Terry Martin injured himself against Fredericton on Thursday night with a bruised lower abdomen. And Mike Sands also not dressed tonight, out with that bruised kneecap sustained last Sunday against Nova Scotia.
Here's Dean DeFazio clearing one into the center ice area. And on right wing, Roger Boulanger spins in his own zone. He's a former first round draft choice, but we're going to have a penalty on the play, and it's going to be against Baltimore. And defenseman Greg Hotham.
Well, Glenn Johannesson doing his job for the Springfield Indians right here. He's moved from defense back to left wing, where he's been shuffling back and forth all season long, trying to create a little bit of havoc there in the Baltimore zone. Greg Hotham got in the way, and it's going to be a two-minute interference penalty to that man right there, the veteran Greg Hotham, with 15 minutes and 16 seconds remaining in this first period. Jim Magoo right off the bat gets Baltimore going in the right direction as he scored for the Jacks, but the Indians with a chance to tie it up here on the power play.
There you see the power play statistics for Springfield. An average power play unit as far as the statistics are concerned. And average against Baltimore this year, 3-for-16, 18.7% in the season series. Now Craig Levy now on the near board for Ari Hanpa. Swept away on the near side by Weir, but jammed up to the near boards. Indians try and work it free to the point for Levy. Winds it back behind the net, but the Jacks take over. And in his own zone is Chris Dahlquist. He can't get it out. Leiter holds it in, but cleared on the near boards, and the Jacks still can't get it out. Loose in front, Hamway tries to make a play. Now to the point, Levy moving right in on goal for Hanpa now, as it was tipped away. Feeds left point for Leiter as the Indians wheel and deal with the power play. Leiter for Levy. Levy back to Leiter. Shoots, blocked off by Carlson, but he gets his own rebound. Right side for Levy. Levy feeds for Hanpa. Back to Levy at the point. Shoots right on. Heron the save. Loose in front. Bad scramble in front of the Heron. Holds on and is able to make the save. And the Jack fans on the near side giving Heron some applause on that save.
Well, the Indians do a good job working the puck around the perimeter. Here's a look at it from ice level. Levy with a chance from the point. Dennis Heron seems to be having a bit of a problem with his rebounds. Right here, he lets that one get away from him, and it goes out in front, almost cost him, because Ari Hanpa, there you see him, number 17, bearing down for Springfield, looking for that rebound, and Hanpa made an excellent play with the body to keep that puck in the Baltimore zone as he took out Wally Weir. Of course, the finished product, no more for the offensive style of play, but it's the physical play that he has to play in the North American game, and he showed it on that hit on Wally Weir.
Faceoff in the Baltimore zone, Scott Howson, along with the Indians, Ron Handy, and also up front, Paul Houck, but play underway in the Jacks, Tom Ralston, clears it all the way down, and the Indians have to go back. 58 seconds left in the Hopton penalty. The Indians down 1-0 as Jim Magoo notched the early goal for Baltimore. As deep in his own zone is Scott Howson. Wheels up the left wing boards, is checked on the play. Good job by Baltimore's Ralston, who leaves it back for his own defense, and the Jacks, Mike Rowe, the rookie, clears, but Diddick shoots it to center ice where Ralston takes over. He clears it ahead all the way down into the Springfield zone where Casey sets it up for his own defense. Just 30 seconds left in the penalty as Scott Howson dashes to center ice, moves into the Baltimore zone, tries to squeeze by Rowe, and then it's checked up by Phil Bork on the play. Then Jensen unable to hold it in, but tipped in by Diddick, and then again cleared outside the line by the Jacks in the neutral zone. Just 10 seconds left in the penalty. As Ron Handy ahead for Scott Howson. He's able to slice one to the Baltimore line, and the Jacks are able to clear one all the way down. That's going to do it on the penalty. Hotham is back on, and the Jacks have killed it off. 1-0 in favor of Baltimore. 13 minutes, 10 seconds left in the opening period. As Ed Lee back for Gerald Diddick for Ed Lee in his own zone. Watch on the near boards, but is able to wheel up the right side. Comes to center ice, gets by Risling, then moves in. Shooting one. Oh, kicked aside by Heron. Now Johannesson back behind the net for Lee, but swept off of his stick, and then Magoo up on left wing. Lee cross ice pass to center for Risling, goes all the way deep into the Springfield zone, where Bill Stewart angles back after. Stewart gets by the forechecking of Risling, then works out of his own zone to center ice. Taps it ahead for Coulter, but banked away at the Jack defense, and then in his own zone, it's Wally Weir. Up the center ice area, and the Jacks take over, and moving in across the line for Baltimore, and trying to move through is the Jack player on the far side. Then it's Weir sweeping one in, but Stewart's able to clear to center, and it's jammed up in the neutral zone. Here come the Indians back. Neil Coulter shoots one. Love save, Heron. Rebound trickles behind the net. Coulter stuffs it in front, and it ends up deflecting wide. Back come the Jacks. Into the center ice area is Gary Risling banking it through, and the Indians have to go back. Very entertaining game here. There's a lot of fast-paced skating. On the left wing side is Ed Lee. Lead pass for Hamway at center. Deflects all the way into the Baltimore end of the rink where Heron sets it up for his own defense. Here is Phil Bork for Baltimore. He's seen some time up with the parent Pittsburgh Penguins. Lead pass across the line. Simpson is checked on the far side by Leiter. Mad scramble on the far boards, taken by the Jacks, who clear one deep into the Springfield zone, and the Indians have to go back. 1-0 in favor of Baltimore here in the first period, as the Indians take control. And moving to center ice is Craig Levy across that Jack line. Wrists in front, Hamway shoots, oh! And Heron kicks it aside. Now it's dropped back to the point. Leiter wrists is one in front, but the Jacks able to intercept and clear into the center ice area. Here's Steve Carlson, wristing one deep into the Springfield zone, and Craig Levy back in his own end of the rink. In for Mark Habscheid, back for Craig Levy. Lead pass up the left wing side. Now Hamway on left wing, trying to move into the Jack zone. Hakes control, centers one through for Diddick, who's cruising through and shoots. Blocked off the defense. Then Diddick takes a stiff check from Dahlquist, and back behind the net, Terry Tate for Scott Howson, but it's broken up by Carlson, and works back for Baltimore. Here's Carlson, wristing one all the way down. That's going to be an icing against Baltimore as Gerald Diddick touches the loose puck in a very entertaining, fast period.
Well, this game has all the makings for it right here. Both clubs involved in the playoff hunt within their division, and you have two goaltenders of NHL caliber opposing each other here tonight in the persons of John Casey for Springfield and this man making the save on the shot by Gerald Diddick. Dennis Herron has that shot blocked in front. Dahlquist took that one away from Didick and then dished him a heavy blow. You see Didick going down to the ice, but Fred Creighton tonight relying on some depth. The big line for Springfield had been Tim Kulas, Gary Lacy, and Neil Coulter. And that line now with a couple of injuries to both Kulas and Lacy out of action. So goes on the shoulders now of Ed Lee and Glenn Johannesson. They had a good shift their last time on the ice.
Now Didick shoots and he just missed by an eyelash. Jammed up far side. Here's Houck for the Tribe. Tries to make a play. Jammed up and fought for as Lamoureux spins back behind the net. And the former Rookie of the Year in the AHL tips it on the near side, but back the other way come the Jacks. Here's Lamoureux on a two-man break. In across the line, feeds one for Risling, but the pass fails to click. Then Lamoureux back behind the net. Tied up by Jensen, loose puck to the point. Dahlquist tries to move in. Spins between the circles and shoots. They score! Well, Chris Dahlquist let it go, but he's not going to get credited for the goal as it was tipped in front. And Baltimore, as you see with the fans on their feet, lead 2-0.
At the 10-minute mark of the first period, Mitch Lamoureux will get the goal for Baltimore. Here you see Dahlquist, a shift around Terry Tate. He's going to move in and take a wrist shot. Casey will make the save, but the rebound right there was not contained. Lamoureux picked it up, and for Dave Jensen could knock him off the puck. Former rookie scoring champ in the American Hockey League a couple years back. He still holds the record for most goals scored by a rookie with 57. Mitch Lamoureux gets his 20th of the year, making it 2-0 Baltimore.
And Lamoureux is going to find that record of his as far as most goals are concerned in a season. Boy, Paul Gardner on the chase right now. Now on the near boards, here's Bill Stewart clearing one ahead, but it ends up going up over the glass and on the near side in the Jacks players bench. We have 9:47 left first period. Baltimore leading 2-0. And as John mentioned, this a key game for Baltimore. Should they lose tonight, they would fall 12 points back of the Indians in the Southern Division race, and it would be a tough one for them. Playing away, it's cleared deep into the Springfield end of the rink where Gort Paddock takes control. Haven't seen much of Paddock this year, and now the near side comes Ron Handy. Handy twists and turns and spins, but blocked off the defense. But Bill Stewart takes over, shoots one. Oh, and it deflects wide. Jammed up near boards, and the Jacks take over. And Mike Rowe able to slide up the middle. Ahead at the center ice area, Tony Fiore is tied up. Now on right wing is Mike Rowe. Jams three in front, but taken away at the near side by Ron Handy, who's able to clear up to center ice. Indians clear one into the Jack end of the rink. Ed Lee takes control on the near side. Mad scramble on the near boards. Five players in there, and finally, also for Springfield, trying to jostle free on the near side for the Tribe is Ron Handy. They end up freezing it up on the near boards.
Well, Baltimore, even though it is such a big game for them, the Indians also realize that this game has a great deal of importance for them also. It's a 7-team race right now, and if the Indians can defeat Baltimore here tonight, it could just become a 6-team race, and when you're going down to the wire, the least amount of teams that you can have involved in the race will do you a lot of good, and that's what the Indians are looking at right now. They can bury the Jacks here tonight if they can beat them and just try to eliminate them from the race, because they'll have their hands full, the Tribe will, as they go down the stretch.
You saw a good shot of Dennis Herron, who, of course, a former William Jennings Trophy winner with Rick Walmsley back in 1982 when Herron and Walmsley were members of the Montreal Canadiens. As the Jacks clear one all the way into the Springfield zone, and on the near boards, Mark Kampschut takes control. Jacks take over on the near side. Yarmo Regan on the near boards tries to make a play, but the Indians' Mark Hamway clears into the center ice area, and Big Johannesson on left wing for Leiter, but tipped away at the defense and cleared back to the Jack line, and Baltimore take over. The Jacks leading 2-0. Mad scramble on the near side, and here is O'Regan fighting off with Craig Levy. They fight for the loose puck, and finally comes free for Habscheid, who shoots it into the Baltimore end of the rink, and the Jacks take over. Baltimore leading 2-0, but loose in front. Fortunately for Baltimore, they're able to work out. Here's DeFazio. Pass ahead on the right wing side for O'Regan, fails to click. Then the Indians wind it back into the Baltimore zone, and Greg Hotham spins back in his own end of the rink. Here is Hotham for Baltimore. Working out, feeds up the alley for the Jacks. O'Regan to DeFazio. He tries to barrel through, but Gerald Didick stands him up beautifully as he knocked DeFazio down. Now it's jammed up far side, taken by Jensen for the Indians. In comes O'Regan. Also for Baltimore's Cullen Chin back behind the goal. On the far side, but tipped away and dropped back to the point. Quick shot by Hotham and deflected in front. And back the other way come the Indians. into the neutral zone comes Paul Houck. Houck across that blue line, pulls up, checking him is Bork. It's centered, but right under the stick of Cullen Chin, who breaks back for Baltimore. The Jacks rookie feeds on the right wing for Simpson. He is pulled down and taken by the Indians as Dave Simpson was tripped up in the Springfield zone.
Dave Simpson, formerly Canadian Junior Player of the Year a few years back, upended Bill Stewart upended Simpson in the process. It'll be a tripping call on the Indians defenseman. There you see Bill Stewart comes out right there to greet Dave Simpson, upends him, and in the process gets the Indians' first penalty of the night. Bill Stewart wearing the captain. There you see right there. First it was Chris Pryor. Pryor went down with an injury. Then Tim Kulis took over the C. With Kulis going by the wayside, it rests now on the shoulders of Bill Stewart, who played an outstanding game in Fredericton, the Indians' last time out on this past Thursday. It was an outstanding effort for Stewart, in which he was the game's third star. Did not figure in the scoring, but on the back line was quite solid.
Play underway, the Jacks take over. And it's cleared back at the point for Dahlquist as the Jacks with the power play opportunity. Loose in front, quick shot, deflects wide. Here is Ralston for the Jacks. Winding one through, but cleared away by the Indians and all the way down. Minute and 42 seconds left in Bill Stewart's penalty. 6:47 left first period. The Jacks leading by a score of 2-0. And now they work out again on the right wing side. Actually in the center ice area as Dahlquist takes over. Leaves it through and now trying to move through for Baltimore is Simpson, but again cleared down and the Jacks take over. Very quiet power play so far, but watch out as Lamoureux feeds for Chin. Tries to split through, blocked off the defense. And then coming back for Springfield is Leiter and shoots one all the way down. And again, Baltimore have to go back in their own zone.
Well, as the fans saw on the screen just a while back, Baltimore lackluster with the man advantage this year, 18.9%. Really, Gene Ubriaco has been pulling his hair out trying to figure out the right combinations on the power play.
And amazingly enough, they have more power play goals than the Indians, but a lot more chances. They've had some 70 more chances on the power play and have only scored 5 more goals than the Indians, as the Indians able to sweep it down again and the Jacks take over. They work up the right wing side. Coming to center ice for Baltimore's Lamoureux. Up to the near boards, and Ralston can't get by the checking of Johannesson, but Chin on the right wing side. Centers it for Pelagia, shot! And Casey's able to get a piece of that. The Indians clear down again, and the Jacks have to go back. 5.5 minutes left, first period, 2-0 Baltimore, 20 seconds left in Bill Stewart's penalty. This is going to be the last opportunity for the Jacks, and a good rush. And now, speeding down the right wing side is the Cambridge, Massachusetts native, and that's Tom O'Regan. Back to the point, Bork, a shot, and that stick save by Casey goes on the left wing boards and cleared away by the Tribe again, and that's going to do it on the penalty as Stewart is back on. The Indians have killed it off. Now DeFazio spins out of his own end of the ring, comes to center and feeds ahead on the left wing side. Back after it for Springfield is Levy, and jammed up back behind the net where O'Regan in after it. He is checked on the play. Hapshide over there. O'Regan in a forecheck and then swept to the near boards as the Indians able to clear, but not out. Jax DeFazio fighting off on the near boards with Craig Levy. They still fight for it, finally taken by the Indians and cleared outside the line where Hamway tries to dash after it, but Bork is all over Hamway. Referee Andre Duhamel watches him passively as it's cleared on left wing and DeFazio speeds in across the line. Can't get the shot off. Good defensive gem by Hamway. Now speeding through is Phil Bork. Spinning behind the net, centers one, and tipped back by Magoo on the near boards. Finally, the Indians able to clear, but not out. And on the second try, Hamway's able to work into the Baltimore zone. Pass through, blocked off the defense, and the Jacks clear to center. Now up to the neutral zone comes Tom Ralston across the line, shoots, he misconnects. Jammed up near boards, and Paul Houck gets to the center ice area. Ari Hanpa races after it, but broken up at the Jack defense, and Ralston feeds it back for his own line. Now on right wing, Lamoureux feeds in. Across the wrestling, right to the top, but tip off there, and back come the Indians. Here's Terry Tate, puts on the Jets. Right side pass for Paul Houck, who shoots. Oh, tip aside by Heron. Now at center, Tate can't control the pass, but we're going to have a penalty on the play. And I believe an interference penalty coming up against Baltimore.
That's exactly the call right here with 3:30 remaining in this first period. Mitch Lammer will skate and take a seat in the penalty box right now for Baltimore. You're going to see the play. Paul Houck coming down the right wing. Big slap shot off the stick of the University of Wisconsin product. It's kicked aside by Heron. You're going to see the penalty coming up right here momentarily as Andre Duhamel had already made the call. It was Handy, the trailer, coming through from that level. You could not see it, but on his way through, he was upended from behind by Lamoureux, which thwarted him from getting in as the trailer, and that's why the penalty is called, putting the Indians on the power play.
It's Lamoureux for interference at 16:30, the Indians' second power play chance of the night. Let's see how they do this time. They need to get one on the boards here to cut the lead to 2-1. Scott House in a drop against Colin Chin. He was a line mate of Ray Stazak on a high-scoring line at the University of Illinois Chicago. Here's Dave Jensen on the near board for the try. Feed for Levy, shoots, deflected away by Heron. Loose to the side of the net, Houston and Carlson fight for it. Mad scramble and taken at the left side by Levy. Cleared for Jensen. For Ron Handy in front for Jensen, but cleared away. At the Jack defense by Colin Chin, and the Indians have to go back. Minute and 30 seconds, just 30 seconds gone in the Baltimore penalty as the Indians work out of their own zone. Here's Scott Housen. Drops it back for zone defense. Then the center ice comes Craig Levy. Trying to burst through, but the whole play offside at the Baltimore blue line. And the Indians seem to be rushing things just a little bit too much.
Yeah, maybe they are. With a minute 20 remaining, they still have plenty of time left on the Lamoureux penalty to do something. 2:50 remaining in that first period. And before this period ends, let's get to tonight's Tribe trivia question if we can. Might not get a chance to get it out the way this game has gone, with plenty of action back and forth. We have yet a chance to show the fans our trivia question. Then, of course, we give the fans the answer in the third period. There it is. This former Indian was the last man to coach the New York Islanders prior to Al Arbor. Who is he? I've got two guesses written down here. Jude Drouin and J.P. Parisi. No, they're both wrong. So you're off to a good start.
Could be here all night then. Now it's dropped back to the point as Hotham clears, but not out. Hapscheid shoots off the side of the net. In comes Johannesson. Dishes it off in front. Stewart a shot. Now back to the lighter, a drive. High off the glass. Heron has lost his stick. They play catch, and finally Heron's able to get that stick as it was handed to him by Phil Bourque. Now Hamway drops it back on the far side. Hapscheid's pass swept away by Carlson, and a dandy job penalty killing. I tell you, Carlson, a wily veteran, and made a good play there to break up a pass. 36 seconds left in the penalty as Hapscheid feeds into the center ice area for Hamway. Hamway across the line, but Johannesson ahead of the play offside at the Baltimore blue line.
31 seconds remain on the Lamoureux penalty. 2:01 left this first period. Baltimore leads at 2-0. We should fill the fans in case they do not know. Of course, the Indians had a few player transactions this week, with Kari Taco going up to the Minnesota North Stars, and from all reports was in goal on Saturday for the North Stars as they dropped a 4-2 decision to Winnipeg. According to reports, Taco faced 34 shots in the goal in his first NHL start. Also, Gord Paddock had joined the Indians in Moncton on this past Wednesday. He, of course, in the lineup tonight. He's up from Muskegon in the International League.
John, if we get some times, we'll fill the fans in on our exciting maritime trip for ourselves, including your always favorite place to eat, Len's Restaurant in Moncton.
It's a great place.
Yeah, it's just wonderful. Here are the Indians working out with just 10 seconds left in the penalty. As into the neutral zone, broken up the defense and cleared right back in. Didick hustles back in his own end of the rink, and the Indians have to go back. Lamoureux is back on. The Jacks have killed it off as the Indians clear it all the way down. Back after Chris Dahlquist and icing his call. Just going to tell the fans that there is a restaurant that John just absolutely has that mouth-watering effect. It's called Len's Restaurant in Moncton, a greasy spoon, you call it.
A greasy spoon, but I affectionately call it a greasy spoon because the food is the best probably in the Maritimes. For the money, for the price, it's a great bargain. It's really low rates for some of the fans who don't know. The Canadian exchange rate is, of course, at a high one right now, but it's very expensive as far as the food up north. But at Len's, you get a great deal for your money. And it's not only me. As you know, Mike, about 8 or 9 members of the Springfield Indians have become disciples of Len's, and they love it there also.
Well, that's what they say. I'm not sure if that's the truth, though. As it's jammed up on the near boards and fought for and back behind the net, the Indians are able to clear as Gary Risling has lost his helmet, and he's going to catch some flack from the fans in just a moment, as Risling's helmet is flying all over the ice. as a clearing pass ahead on the far side. If our cameraman can get a good shot of Gary Ristling down there on the near boards. There you see him skating on the near side and to the Baltimore players' bench. There you see Gary with that air that's getting down there a little bit. And I tell you, he takes flack from the fans.
He sure does, but I wouldn't want to walk down an alley and say that to him. I'd compliment him on his hairstyle because he has 302 minutes in penalties and throughout his career has been one of the roughest competitors in the game. And there you see him losing his headgear and in the process a few jeers from the crowd.
Minute and 1 second left in this first period, a 2-0 encounter in which the Indians trail. Jim Magoo and Mitch Lamoureux, the skipjack tallies tonight as the Jacks intent on stealing a couple of points here in Springfield unless the Indians can get going. On the right wing side, Paul Houck works into the Baltimore zone. He's bumped off the puck. Now Scott Elson for the try. Drops it back to the point. Here's Paddock's shoot shot. Oh, and that deflects wide. Terry Tate scoots in. Tries to center for Houck with 40 seconds left in the period. To Stuart Rister in front. Deflected. Heron the stop as Housen got a piece of it, but Heron was able to somehow see it and hold on.
Well, Dennis Heron has not allowed a goal yet in this first period. Just 36 seconds remaining, but he seems a little bit shaky on a couple of chances here. As you're going to see the Indians' last scoring bid, Heron will make the stop as Bill Stewart sends it in toward the net, and there you see him lose his balance. Scotty Housen trying to get in to get to that loose puck, but Wally Weir, the roadblock between him and Heron. But Dennis Heron has had a few problems with rebounds tonight. He's been shaky on a couple of stops he's made. The Indians, before tonight's out, if they continue to pepper him, could find the answer to that puzzle.
Scott Housen against Tom O'Regan. Now, the rule was dropped and Fairley will do it over again. 36 seconds left in this first period as Greg Hoffman now comes over to replace. Hey, you can't do that. Nope, he's gonna be sent back. Andre Duhamel right there.
You should bring a whistle up here with you, that's.
Nope, you can't do that. Duhamel, they were trying to little get by him. You can't do things like that. All right, play underway, it's cleared right back as the Jacks take over in their own zone. And spinning back in his own zone for Baltimore is Wally Weir. Clears to center ice where Bill Stewart angles back after it. It's shot right back in, and the Jacks take over in their own zone. Just 20 seconds left in the frame as Terry Tate knocks down a pass. Centers for Housen. Wheels right in front. Centers for Houck. Back to the Indians. Tate, who tries to get a shot off. 10 seconds left, but Carlson's able to clear to center. Here's Ralston now for the Jacks. Across that line. Tries to move in front, centered for O'Regan, and batted wide, and the buzzer sounds, signaling the end of the period. Both teams having scoring chances in the last 20 seconds.
An exciting finish to this first period of play here with time running out in the first frame. The Indians down by two. We're going to see the final action right here. I believe it's Bill Stewart that's going to come flying through here to rescue the Springfield Indians as Tom Rolston has the puck. He, of course, the leading scorer in this Baltimore club. He centers one out in front for O'Regan. Casey makes the stop. The rebound pops up into the air. Bill Stewart bats it away there as Baltimore pressing for their third. The Indians plenty of chances there late in the first period. Dennis Heron held his ground, although he gave up a couple of rebounds in front. The Indians were knocking at the door, but have yet to get in after one.
Okay, hope you're enjoying the action. John and I will be back and we'll fill you in on all the excitement in the American Hockey League. There's so much to talk about. We'll be back in just a moment.
Someone you know has recently been injured as a result of someone else's negligence, you need qualified legal counsel to protect the rights guaranteed you by law. And our firm would like to provide that counsel.
Call attorney Frank Arcega today at 736-3611. Your initial consultation is free, and you pay no fee whatsoever unless and until compensation is awarded for your claim. So call now, 736-3611.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Ferrick with John Forslund. The Baltimore Skipjacks, in desperate need of a victory, have come up with an early 2-0 lead.
Well, they definitely look like they're ready for this game tonight, Mike. They come out of the gate flying, score early on, but the Indians with some great plays in their own end. Dennis Herron so far has been the answer for Baltimore. The Indians have to keep persisting the same way they have been over the past week, and I think here at home against Baltimore, if they continue the same work ethic, they'll be okay in this week.
Okay, as usual at our between periods activities, between periods 1 and 2, we take a look at what's happening in the American Hockey League, and it's getting late. Just 15 games left for the Springfield Indians, including tonight's action. There you see the Northern Division standings in a battle, as usual, between Adirondack and Maine, with Moncton in third place in the Northern Division. And, John, the Nova Scotia Oilers, we saw them on Sunday night, last Sunday, and they're making a last-ditch effort to try and make a playoff spot.
Well, for Larry Kish and the Oilers, let's hope it's not too late against the Indians on Sunday night. They really didn't come out of the gate flying at home. They were there a day early, and the Indians traveled all day long, and really a lackluster performance for the Oilers in that one. But they seem to have picked up the pace, but they better hurry. There you see Fredericton and Sherbrooke, of course, battling for the fourth spot. That'll probably be the big battle in that division. The top three spots probably now solidified, unless Moncton folds up, but I don't think they will. The bottom three will fight it out for the fourth spot.
Let's take a look at the Southern Division standings, and what a jam up as usual. But the Springfield Indians now in a little bit more comfortable of position after that Maritime swing with 66 points. Not really a lot of breathing room, but the Indians have four games at hand over New Haven, who are tied with the Indians right now.
Well, the Indians have a big week coming up, and even though they might be comfortable right now, they play Rochester twice, and then, of course, Hershey coming up, who's always tough, and a lot of games with the Southern Division. Anything can happen at this point, Mike, and do the Indians some justice, to do away with Baltimore here tonight and make it extremely difficult for them and just keep it a 6-team race, at least for now.
One mention, the New Haven Nighthawks continue to be the hottest team in the league. In their last 18 games, the Nighthawks have won 14 and lost only 3, one game in a tie. I'll tell you, they continue to roll. They're the surprise team of the South. Okay, let's take a look at what's happening as far as the Indian statistics are concerned. Alan Kerr, of course, the leader. And you know, I was thinking about this. Rod Handy has 52 points. Now, if Alan Kerr stays up the rest of the year, Handy, for the second straight year, could end up the leading scorer for the Springfield Indians, and nobody would probably know that.
Ron Handy does it in a very quiet manner, but one thing's for certain, Ron Handy can be relied on around that net. He has a great deal of talent, and he might just do the same thing. He's the Indians' leading scorer a year ago, and he did that without not much notoriety. The same might hold true this year.
Okay, and let's take a look at what's happening as far as the top scorers in the AHL are concerned. Paul Gardner, 50 goals. Now, he's just 7 away from tying the all-time American Hockey League scoring record with 8. It's all Paul Gardner.
And it's been Paul Gardner, because Rochester, with their injury problems and Gage on recall, he's been the sole offense for the Rochester Americans, and yet another great year for that player who was the Minor League Player of the Year a year ago, doing the same this year.
He's also a good candidate for the American Hockey League's MVP trophy at the end of the season. Okay, now let's take a look at the upcoming schedule for Springfield. There you see Wednesday night, the Indians in Rochester. Now, this past Sunday, the Indians will have already played the Maine Mariners in a big game. Then Friday night and Saturday night, I tell you, if the fans don't come out for those two games, Hershey and Rochester, those are going to be thrilling contests at the center on Friday and Saturday night.
And there's only two left after that, so there's not much time for the fans to come out and get behind this Indians team that definitely needs it down the stretch, because it's going to be an exciting finish that could go down the final week.
Hershey and Rochester coming up on the weekend. Get your tickets now. Okay, that's the story here at the center, a 2-0 score. Tim Kulas, player that's helped the Indians since joining the team, since being sent down by the Minnesota North Stars, will be John's guest in just a moment. We'll be back in just a bit.
If you or someone you know has recently been injured as a result of someone else's negligence, you need qualified legal counsel to protect the rights guaranteed you by law. And our firm would like to provide that counsel.
Call attorney Frank Arcega today at 736-3611. Your initial consultation is free, and you pay no fee whatsoever unless and until compensation is awarded for your claim. So call now, 736-3611.
Well, a year ago, the man on my right was a big reason why the Springfield Indians were one of the most exciting clubs in the American Hockey League until mid-February. During that time, this man was recalled, the Minnesota North Stars, and from that point on, the Indians lost a little bit of character. This season, it's a different story. Tim Kulas has been up all year long with the Minnesota North Stars,
And even though for Tim coming down to Springfield, this has been a big surprise for the Indians fans. And Timmy, you've had a big impact on this Indians team since coming down. And you'll probably say it's not have anything to do with me because it's such a team game, but you've had an impact on what's going on over the past couple of weeks.
Well, thank you, John. But we've got a good young team here, and I'm just really glad to be part of a hard-working organization. The team here, like I said, is young, but my influence, you know, I've been around for a few years now, and, you know, hopefully I can give them a little bit of leadership.
What do you pass along to the guys? Maybe the fans don't get the chance to see it, of course, because it's on the ice. But let's talk about practice sessions. Let's talk about off the ice. What do you pass along to the young guys when it's getting down to crunch time, really, the end of the year?
Well, basically, there's not really a whole lot you can say. It's a matter of work habits, and, you know, I go out and I try to work as hard as I can, and if the younger guys see this, you know, maybe just make them work a little bit harder, too.
I think it shows, really, the line you've been on of late until your injury, of course, until Gary Lacy's injury. You, Lacy, and Neil Poulter doing outstanding work, and we talked about that line, and Fred mentioned maybe this line won't get a lot of points for it, but they'll certainly work hard, but the points did come as a result of the work.
Yeah, for sure. Like, Neil and Lace, they're both good young hockey players, you know. They work hard and they grind it out, which makes it a lot easier for me, you know. And we're not really known as a scorer, all three of us, but we work hard and world has been becoming a little bit.
Right now, though, you're shelved with this injury. Fill the fans in a little bit about the injury, what's going on, and what the prognosis is as far as you getting back in the lineup.
Well, it happened here last Friday night. Against Adirondack, I guess it was. And I was tripped on the play and my ankle went out and it twisted my knee and I bruised the nerve in there. And now I have sort of like club foot where I had no control lifting my foot up. And I played the next three games after that and it just didn't seem to get any better. But hopefully just with a few days off, things will come around.
Coming off the injury, of course, injuries have played a part of your season this season, starting right off the bat in training camp, and there's been a lot of talk about that injury, and I'm sure something you like to put behind you, but for you, not the best way to start the season.
Yeah, that's for sure. That one happened in training camp off ice. I wasn't even on the ice yet, and we had an off-ice program, and I stepped on a tennis ball and had surgery on my right ankle. But, you know, you just got to bounce back as best you can and contribute as much as you can to the hockey team.
This season, of course, up with the Minnesota North Stars and with a guy who, of course, you got a lot of respect for last season, Roaren Henning. Roaren Henning in his first year full-time behind the bench in the American Hockey League last season did a great job with this Indian club, getting him in the playoffs and then finally a promotion to Minnesota. How about the job he's done with the fellas up in Minnesota at this point?
Outstanding. Roaren, like, it's Minnesota last year when I was up there, they've got a lot of talent in the team, a real lot of talent. But there's a problem with attitudes up there, and Roaren came in this year, and you know things were the way they were last year. And slowly, he's trying to turn things around and get in the people that he wants, and just know let the players know that he's the boss. And I can't say enough about Roaren, and as a coach and as a person himself. And I think he's going to be around the NHL for a long, long time.
It seems to me, and I'd like to get your opinion, that maybe it's a matter of respect. The guys really seem to respect Roaren. They did here last year. And do you think at the NHL level, it's got to be difficult sometimes to get the guys' respect? And you think Roaren's doing the job in that regard?
Oh, there's no doubt about it. You know, you talk to Roaren, he doesn't beat around the bush, you know, he doesn't pull any punches. He tries to be as honest as he can be. And you hit it on the head there. You got to respect your coach before you can start playing for him.
Now, Tim Pulis this season plays for the Minnesota North Stars and plays sparingly. And I'm sure for you, you didn't. Once you got back from the injury, the ice time wasn't there for you, and you're sent down to Springfield. Now, the fans, it's like a double-edged sword here, really, when you look at it. The fans see Tim Pulis in the lineup and say, well, gee, here he is, and he's going to help us make the playoffs and see how far we can go. But for you, your goal to make the National Hockey League, and I know it's a burning desire in yourself, how do you deal with that, being so well-liked here in Springfield, but still you want to get back to the NHL?
Yeah, you're right, John. Like, I've only got one or two more years left in me, you know, to actually prove that I can play in the NHL. I thought I'd have a good chance this year, but like I said, Minnesota's got a lot of talented hockey players, and I just didn't seem to fit in at the time. But, you know, I come down here and work hard, and hopefully I'll get another shot at it.
Coming down to Springfield, gentleman by the name of Fred Creighton. He's been around a long time. I know he's coached against you in the past, but maybe this is your first dealing with him on a one-to-one basis as far as being your coach. How, what are your impressions? I know you've only been here for 2 weeks, but what about Fred?
Yeah, I've only been here for 2 weeks, but I've played against Fred for about against his team for about 4 years. And he's always had hard-working teams that never quit. And Fred is an unbelievable great guy. He's from the old school, you know. He's been around for many years. I'm sure he can tell you a lot of stories. And I've got a lot of respect for Fred. And, you know, he's in a tough situation with players coming and going, too. But, you know, you got to do the best that you can. And with Fred, all you got to do is go out there and work hard, and he'll keep playing you.
As you look down the stretch now and see the group of fellas here in Springfield, the guys who are injured and the guys who are going to come back from injury and, of course, play a big part, how far do you think this Indians team can go if they put it all together and gel as a unit?
Oh, there's no question this team can go as far as they want to go. But that's the whole key, believing in yourselves and knowing that you can do it. I find a little bit of lack of confidence here. And, you know, you can't go into any kind of a game because the team has more points than you, or because you're short players or anything. You got to go into a game knowing that you can win the game regardless of any kind of circumstances. And if we can get the young guys believing in themselves, I think there's no stopping this team.
Timmy, as far as the future goes for yourself, what do you see as far as your career, where you stand right now, and what lies ahead?
That's a tough one. I had to ask it. That's tough. Like I was just saying, I'm probably going to play maybe one or two more years, and then I'll go back to my hometown and just settle down and start getting a regular 9-to-5 job. But still, I want to prove to myself that I can play in the NHL. And, you know, I go out every game trying to give the fans their money's worth. And as long as I can go out of the game giving the game as much as it's given to me, I'll be happy.
One thing's for certain, when number 11 hits the ice, you do give the fans their money's worth and give us the money's worth in the broadcast booth. Tim, good luck to you now, and I hope you get back from that injury. We need you on the ice, and that's where the Indians want to have you. So good luck, get healthy, and get back out there.
Thank you very much.
Tim Kulis, left winger in the Springfield Indians, has been our guest between periods. Indians down at this point, 2-0 after one, but looking to come back. We'll have second period action coming up right after this on Continental Cablevision.
Personal injuries can be extremely costly, both physically and financially. But if you've been injured through someone else's negligence, don't let financial considerations prevent you from getting the legal advice you need.
Call attorney Frank Arcega today at 736-3611. Your initial consultation is free, and you pay no fee whatsoever unless and until compensation is awarded for your claim. So call now, 736-3611.
There's a place I know, New England's all.
Take a look at Springfield.
We're proud to let our spirit show.
Take a look at us.
At the crossroads of New England, where the Connecticut River flows.
There's a neighborhood to call your own. Take a look at Springfield. In Springfield, you'll feel right at home.
Stop trying to do your taxes all by yourself.
Harry, we called the IRS and found out there's a tax aid program right down.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Barrick with John Forslund here at the Springfield Civic Center. The Indians outshot Baltimore 14-6 in the opening frame, but find themselves down 2-0.
Well, the Indians have to keep up the same work habits they had in that first period. Surge ahead on Dennis Herron. Looks like he can be beaten here tonight, but the Indians have to keep it going. And as you see, that young fan would love to see the Tribe come back in this one.
Play back into the Springfield zone where Gerald Diddick, the 20-year-old defenseman out of the Western Hockey League, hands on the near board for Dave Jensen ahead of center ice, tipped into the jack into the rink where Herron himself clears on the left wing side. Now the Indians trying to work through. Johannesson back behind the net, tries to center, but scooped up into the center ice area, and the Indians have to go back. Here's Dave Jensen back in his own zone, watched by Risling, and he clears but not out. Tipped by Bork on the far board, then swept back behind the net where Risling takes over. Drops it back to the point. Quick shot, right on by Hoffman. And a stick save by Casey. Matt Scramble back behind the net. Lamoureux tries to center. Then Ralston is knocked down. Diddick takes a hit, jammed up on the near boards, and finally Ron Handy can't get it out. Risling closes through behind the net for Lamoureux. Centers in front, locked off the defense. Then the Jacks take over. Back behind the net, it's worked free. Loose in front, but finally tipped away by Johannesson. Lead pass to center, but ahead of the play offside is Handy. Now we have a scrap back of the play as Phil Bork has some words with Neil Coulter, and they trying to get at each other now. I think that Bork was knocked down to the ice, and then he tried to get back at Coulter, but the linesman quickly came in.
Well, some excitement here early in the second period, 18:51 remaining. The Indians down by two at this point, as you see Neil Coulter in the penalty box, and Phil Bork will accompany him to the same location of the arena momentarily. You're going to see the play in the Springfield end right here. It's Coulter and Bork that are going to get involved in the play as it's going to work its way out of the zone. The Indians had a great chance. Glenn Johannesson fed Ron Handy, who would have been in free right here. It's a two-line pass. As you see, Handy just one stride over that red line. Johannesson inside the Springfield line. Two lines in that pass, and that's a no-no. And there you see Phil Bork, the Boston boy, in the penalty box for Baltimore. They're both going to get minors in this situation, probably 2 minutes each for roughing. It's high sticking here with 18:51 remaining in the second period. And both clubs with matching penalties to Coulter and Bork will be a man short.
Play underway and the Indians take over. The team skating four apiece as far as skaters are concerned as the Indians work up the right side. Here's Levy, lead pass to center for a half shot. Broken up in the defense, then cleared to the near boards, and working free is O'Regan's shot right on. Casey gets a piece of that. Drop back to the point. Dahlquist a shot that also deflected by DeFazio over the glass and into the crowd.
Well, the Indians' parent clubs will have a couple of games on tap this week. Tuesday, March 11th, the Minnesota North Stars will be hosting the Stanley Cup champ Edmonton Oilers. The New York Islanders will also be at home to take on the Calgary Flames. And then both clubs swing in action again on Thursday, March 13th, with the Islanders right in our neck of the woods as they take on the Hartford Whalers. Minnesota, big game within the division as they go to the arena in St. Louis to meet the Blues.
Now play back into the Springfield zone where Craig Levy takes control. Levy feeds on the far boards, but knocked down by DeFazio. He centers in front for O'Regan, but here comes Hamway back, moving into the Baltimore zone. Has Leiter on the left, tries to pass in front, but picked off at the defense, and the Jacks able to clear up the left wing side. Lead pass for DeFazio, bumped off the puck by Levy. Puck rolls back behind the Springfield net where Mark Habscheid controls for the Tribe. Habscheid spun off the puck. Then on the near boards, it's cleared up to the center ice area where Hamway for Springfield. Ahead for Leiter. Off of his stick as the Indians having trouble working into the Baltimore zone. Then O'Regan in the center ice area feeds cross ice from the left wing boards. Moving in for Baltimore as Rowe tries to center one. Then tipped off to the near side by Magoo, and back come the Indians. Here is Mark Hamway shooting one through. Jacks back after it in their own zone. Here is Chris Dahlquist, the rookie who played for Lake Superior State, checked on the play. Jammed up and fed to center ice and knocked back on the far boards and up to the center ice area. Here are the Jacks moving through. Pass to O'Regan. His shot. Caroms wide and Ed Lee takes over. Skates into the Baltimore zone. Pulls up. Wrist shot deflected away by Herron. Lee gets his own rebound. Squeezed off the puck as Hotham's over there. And then the Jacks able to take control back behind the net. Here's Carlson spinning one back behind the goal as it continues to be fought for on the near boards. The players are back on Bork and Coulter Teams now at five skaters aside as it's jammed back behind the net where Bill Stewart is able to clear one ahead on right wing, but too far ahead for Neil Coulter. Now the Jacks in their own zone. Wally Weir, seven-year professional, feeds up to the center ice area. And on the attack is Jim Magoo. Drop pass in front. Simpson shot is handled by Casey. Matt Scramble back behind the net. Now drop to the point. Hotsama shot. Casey gets a piece of that as he was way out of the crease. And the loose puck rolls deep into the Springfield zone. Back after it is Wally Weir. Weir, whose mother lives in Holyoke, Massachusetts, clears it on the far board. Diddick pinching in. Bouncing puck and on left wing, the Jacks have a break. Down the left wing side. Quick shot deflected wide as the Jacks' Boulanger move through. Now to center ice is Scott Housen. Housen is poke checked at the line and the Jacks have to go back in their own end of the rink. It's 2-0 in favor of Baltimore. We played 4 minutes and 10 seconds into this second period. And the pass to center ice ahead on the near side for Risling offside.
15:37 remaining in the second period. It's a 2-0 game here with the Indians and the Baltimore Skipjacks involved in this one here tonight. An entertaining game here tonight, no question about it. The Indians have a couple of home games coming up this weekend. Chance for you, the fan, to come out and see this Springfield Indians try to make the playoffs here in the American Hockey League, and the search will be on for it this Friday night. The Hershey Bears, top the Southern Division right now, will be in town for a 7:30 start, and then the Rochester Americans, the final appearance of the year. As a matter of fact, it will be the final appearance for both Hershey and Rochester this weekend, March 14th and 15th, game time 7:30 here at the center.
Playing away, bouncing puck on the far boards and taken in the neutral zone now by Baltimore. Pass ahead, broken up, and here comes Leiter. Dashing across that line for Handy. Handy's pass for Vern Smith, broken up, and Baltimore able to sweep it out the center ice. Risling pass, broken up, and here come the Indians back. Levy trying to move through across the line, but it's offside with 15:14, left second period, 2-0 Baltimore.
Now there's a big St. Patrick's Day dance concert coming up here at the Springfield Civic Center. The Civic Center, in association with WAQI, is bringing in NRBQ, The Fools and Blotto, on Saturday night, March 15th. Tickets are available $11 on the day of the show, $9.50 in advance. But for you Indians fans, just $6 with the ticket stub from the game on the 15th when the Indians take on Rochester. Be a great night to get shamrocked here at the center.
And for anybody that goes, you'll get to see John Forslund do the two-step at the top of the stage. And that is an added attraction, just to mention to the fans. So that might be the key to that extra ticket purchase that they might not have gotten. So just remember that as the Jacks able to clear out the center as the fans thought there should have been a penalty on the play as Levy spins back in his own rink and will have a face-off back in the Baltimore zone while Andre Duhamel has some wrath from the fans.
Now the fans giving Andre Duhamel a piece of their mind here. And he really has let things go in this hockey game. Not too many penalties called. You're going to see some of the action right here. The Indians trying to get that puck and keep it in the Baltimore zone right there. And there you see Vern Smith upended on the play, but Duhamel let that one go. Clear cut fashion. Looked like Vern Smith definitely taken out, but no call on the play.
And you are going to be doing that two-step, am I correct?
Well, you never know. The fans are going to have to get their tickets, which are on sale now at the Civic Center. Datatix and all Ticketron outlets in the area. You might see me on stage. I just might make a special guest appearance.
Now the Jacks move in as they quickly, Magoo, a shot but blocked off the defense. O'Regan winds it back on the near side. It's centered, tipped to the near boards, and Hapshide trying to clear up, but Bill Stewart angling on the near boards. Clears up the middle, and here come the Indians. Hapshide on left wing for Hanpa. Moving in for Hapshide. Back for Hanpa, and he'll go back, hit or score! And the Indians have made it a 2-1 game as the Tribe able to work it through into the Baltimore zone.
There you see him out of Tampere, Finland. Ari Hanpa getting the goal, his third of the season. He comes barreling down the wing right here, feeds it to his line mate Mark Hapshide, who has been on fire. They work a little give and go right there, and Hanpa, who has been flying all night long, and there was some question even whether or not he was going to play tonight. He's been nursing a bad shoulder, but Hanpa has really been flying and been a force for the Indians here tonight. Gets the Tribe on the board at the 6-minute mark. making it 2-1 Baltimore.
Now Hapshine, a six-game scoring streak as he set up on Pump. Loose puck back behind the net. It's Carlson. Wheels in front, centers, but broken up at the Indians' defense. And here come the Indians on a three-man break to center. Housen shoots one off the stick of Rowe and into the crowd. 13:38 left second period. We have Scott Housen now down to the ice. And now up slowly is Eddie Tyberski to attend one. The scoring play was Hanfod, third for Springfield. Mark Hapshot and Mark Hamway, the assists at 6 minutes.
Scott Housen has been another one of those players who has not been at 100% when the Indians were in the Maritimes. Scotty in Moncton was upended on a play and he injured himself around the tailbone area, and also that ankle was flaring up a little bit on him. Basically just battered and bruised at this point. Upended up on the play, but gets up under his own power after a few words from Eddie Tyberski, and looks like he'll be able to continue in this one.
13:38 left second period. It's a 2-1 game in favor of the Baltimore Skipjacks. And into the center ice area, Greg Hotham wrists it through. Gerald Dittick back after. Gets by the forechecking of Colin Chin, and then on right wing, Ed Lee for the try. Three-man rush into the Baltimore zone. Tries to squeeze through, but tipped away and knocked down on the far boards. In comes Hout for Springfield. Centers in front. Quick shot right on. Stopped by Heron, and then it's cleared out to the center ice area, and the Indians have to go back. Now Carlson breaking through. Tries to feed one in front. Does for Chin. Across. Oh, and Casey. A tremendous save on Mike Rowe. Then it's cleared back on the far boards, and here come the Indians once more. Across the line is Coulter, a pass for Tate, but it's offside after Tate lost his helmet in the Baltimore end. But Casey made a super dazzling stop on Rowe.
He certainly did, as Rowe came in unpunched from his point position. Right there, Steve Carlson had no friends when he crossed the Springfield blue line, but as he waited and waited, finally he found Colin Chin. Then Chin made a deke around Bill Stewart. Lo and behold, there's Mike Rowe coming in from his point position. John Casey, a great stop right there. With 12:48 remaining in the second period, keeping the game 2-1 in favor of Baltimore.
Rowe, formerly of Toronto of the Ontario Hockey League. Now the loose puck at center ice, and fighting for it is Belanger. He moves into the Springfield zone, pass ahead, and it's offside as the newcomer Tony Fiore was ahead of the play offside.
Well, prior to that rush in by Baltimore in the Springfield zone, the Indians had their own scoring chance on Dennis Heron. Paul Hout kept the puck in along the right wing boards in the Baltimore zone. He and Terry Tate did a little give and go action, as did Hapshot and Hanpa on the Springfield goal. Tate with the shot, and Dennis Heron, you take a look at him right there. He made just an excellent kick save on the drive by Tate.
Indians have the line for the tribe of Ron Handy with Glenn Johannesson. And on the right side for Springfield is Neil Coulter. Is the loose puck bouncing around in front, and pouncing on it is the netminder Heron, and he's able to make the stop as our picture up here is gone awry. But 12:18 left second period, 2-1 in favor of Baltimore.
Well, the monitor might be out up here in the booth, but I tell you, it was a great play there made by Glenn Johannesson. Ron Handy had the puck behind the net, fed it out in front, and Johannesson was right on the doorstep, only to be stopped by Dennis Heron. We don't get a chance to see it up here on our monitor, Mike, but I tell you, it was a great scoring bid for Springfield. 12:18 remaining in the second period. Baltimore, a 2-1 lead over the Indians, but the Indians look like they're coming back.
12:18 left second period. The Jacks have goals by Jim Magoo and Mitch Lamoureux. Ari Hanpa the tally for the Tribe as the Jacks take over and clear one on left wing. Into the neutral zone, here comes Wally Weir. The picture magically appears back after John fiddled with it as the loose puck taken on the far boards, and Bill Stewart for the Indians clears ahead on the right wing side, but then knocked ahead in the center ice area.
11:57 remaining in the second period, approaching the halfway mark here. The Indians with some good chances on Dennis Heron, John Casey. Here you see him right there. University of North Dakota product who began the year with the Springfield Indians, played in six games, and for the entire year has been up with the Minnesota North Stars, but lately has been struggling a bit. Sent down as they flip-flop goaltenders, with Taco going up to Minnesota, Casey coming down to regain some of that lost confidence.
Casey, a former Hap Holmes winner of in the AHL last year with this same Baltimore team, as Mark Hamway on right wing leads a rush to center, pass through ahead for Hapshot, goes all the way into the Jack zone. And Heron sets it up for zone defense. Dahlquist winds, but not out. In comes Stewart, feeds one through. Dahlquist breaks it up and clears on the near side, out the center, and the loose puck taken at the Indians' defense. Here's Court Paddock. Right wing pass into the center ice area, and Hamway ducking through. Pass on the near side, but the Jacks break back. Magoo at center, trying to move through. Across for DeFazio. Wrist shot, and that deflects high and wide. Mad scramble as it's jammed free to the left of the Springfield net. In comes Jim Magoo. He and Hapscheid fight fourth and tipped away on left wing for Ari Hanpak. Here's Hanpak dashing to center. Backhands one in, and the Jacks have to go back. 10.5 minutes left in the second period. A 2-1 score in favor of Baltimore as the Jacks move through on the left wing side. Phil Bork wrists one and handled by Casey. Now it's centered right under the stick of the Indians, and Paul Hull. Cross-ice pass for Terry Tate fails to connect, and then Tate leaves it back for his own defense as Jensen has to hustle back. In comes Ralston, but taking over on the second opportunity is Diddick. He's able to clear to center, and the Jacks Hotham in his own zone takes control. Feeds cross-ice into the center ice area, but Jensen ahead. Across for Hulk to Tate. Wrist one wide. On the far side, Ed Lee for the Indians tries to tip one through. Verdidic tries to center one. Bumped off the puck by Bork, and then Hulk for the Indians. Hulk on the right wing side as the Indians try and feed one in front, but Lamoureux breaks it up and feeds the center. Now across the line is Gary Risling. Risling wrists one wide of the target as well. Lamoureux winds it back to the near side. Risling for Baltimore. Feeds it back to the point. Quick shot is blocked down. Now in front. Jacks quickly in front. And the stop made by Casey on Ralston from the doorstep. And the loose puck taken by Wally Weir in his own zone. Action starting to pick up a little bit more in this second period as Lamoureux feeds one into the Springfield zone. But Casey clears one over the glass on the near side.
From point blank range, John Casey robbing his ex-teammate Tom Ralston, who had a brilliant scoring bid in the Springfield zone. Ralston had Casey dead to rights. You're going to see it right here. All alone in front, Tom Ralston, when he, of course, the leading scorer on this Baltimore club with 35 goals, 41 assists for 75 points. And when you give him a golden opportunity like that, he usually lights the lamp, but that's not the situation right there. John Casey held his ground and stood tall, coming up with the save. Of course, Casey last season backbone this Baltimore club to the finals of the American Hockey League, only eventually to lose to the Calder Cup champion Sherbrooke Canadians, but Baltimore a force as they upset Binghamton to win the Southern Division.
Cullen Chin to take the draw against the Indians' Ron Handy. Play underway, it's taken by the Indians, and Ken Leiter spins back in his own zone. Back on the far side for Craig Levy into the neutral zone, and Ron Handy for the Indians. Wrists one through. Johannesson scoots in after it, trying to make a play as he gives for Handy. Then it's fought for. Handy is upended, and now we have a stoppage of play on the far side.
Well, Glenn Johannesson shaking up there. You take a look at him right there as he gets up under his own power. Does not look to be injured on the play as he collided with Ron Handy. Here you see it as it goes into the corner. Johannesson trying to duck underneath Dave Simpson. Simpson rode him into the boards. Now Handy's going to come in, try to scoop that puck out, backpedal his way out, in the process sidestep Johannesson. Handy with a little ballet right there. Looks
kinda
like... What's that?
I was going to say, kind of like your two-step dance for this coming week.
I don't know about this two-step. I don't know what the two-step is. Maybe I'll be in the vicinity of that concert, but the two-step, I think that went out with the days of burlesque in the 20s. I'll have to do some research on that.
Now playing away, quick shot right on, and Casey stops the Jack player in front, and that was Baltimore's Cullen Chin. Now back in his own zone is the Indians' Craig Levy. Levy is bumped off the loose puck. Mad scramble to the left of Casey as the jam up taken by Baltimore. Here's Carlson. Back to the point for Dahlquist, the shot, that is blocked. Then Levy pulls down a Jack player and a penalty coming up against number three.
Well, the Jacks had the Indians hard-pressed in their own end. Craig Levy upended Steve Carlson, gets the penalty for hooking. As you take a look at it right here, comes at the 11:30 mark of this second period. It'll put the Indians a man short. Play running around in the Springfield zone right there, and there you see it. Carlson trying to catch up with the loose puck. Levy had him hauled from behind and brought him down There you see the man they call Cowboy, Craig Levy, who's a big fan of the rodeo. And there you see him right there in the penalty box, toweling off, and he's going to have a seat now and hopefully watch his club kill off this Baltimore power play.
Time of the penalty, 11:30. This the Jacks' opportunity here. This is their second power play chance of the night. And they failed to score in their first chance, and the Jacks take over on the far board. Baltimore leading 2-1. Trying to work through, Terry Tate bumped off the puck, and then Baltimore's Greg Hotham to center ice. Feeding one through across the line for Mitch Lamoureux. He winds one back to the far side. As Baltimore's Belanger tips it to the far side. Is Baltimore working on this power play? Drop back to the point. Quick shot deflected in front and blocked off, but then taken on the near boards. Here's Hotham feeding it through to the point in front for Lamoureux. Shoots. Oh, and Casey, a dazzling stop. And then Bill Stewart and Baltimore's Gary Risling have some words after Lamoureux robbed on a highway robbery by John Casey.
Oh, if we can see this one again, Baltimore with some chances, and the youngster Gord Paddock on defense doing yeoman-like work. Here you see it. Puck redirected on the way through, goes off the skate of Bill Stewart, picked up right there by Risling. He's going to start the play off by trying to get it back to his point position, but Lamoureux was in the way, intercepted it, but still had the semblance of mind to get it back to both points as they worked that puck around and crisscrossed it. It finally got back to Lamoureux. Great stop there by Casey. Here you're going to see some jamming in front. Bill Stewart trying to take out Gary Risling right there, and then Paddock coming in at the tail end.
Now quick shot deflects wide as Belanger on the far board. Winds it back behind the net as the Jacks work it on the far side. Belanger shoots one high and wide and into the crowd on the near side as we're going to get a shot of it right here with 7.5 minutes left in this second period.
Still plenty of time for Baltimore. The faceoff, though, because Baltimore took the shot, was not touched by Springfield, is going to come outside the line, so that's a good break for the Tribe right here. But 1:04 remain on the Levy penalty, so still some time. If Baltimore gets control of that puck and starts wheeling it in that Springfield zone, they have two gunners at the point using Tom Rolston, Gene Ubriaco, with four forwards out on this power play. Greg Hotham, the other man on the point from that right point position. We've seen Hotham this year. He can really blast that puck.
Hotham, 30 years of age, his birthday yesterday. And a couple of veterans on the back line with Wally Weir also at age 31. So some veterans on the blue line for Baltimore as it's jammed up back behind the net. Baltimore trying to work and make a play in the Springfield zone. They work it on the far boards. Here is Risling, feeds it on the far side. Now Risling on the second opportunity, unable to make a play, and then the Jacks Ralston has to go back. 40 seconds left in Greg Levy's penalty as Terry Tate sweeps it into the Jack end of the rink, and then Tom Ralston takes control. Baltimore working up on the attack. Here comes Belanger into the center ice area. Gets by Coulter and falls to his duff. Loose puck taken and swept by Smith, but broken up there at the defense. And then on right wing, Neil Coulter bursting down, moving in shorthanded. Goes against Hotham, then spins in front, centers, and broken up by Baltimore. Here's Risling moving to center ice. One on two, tries to make a play and then just backhands it deep into the Springfield zone. That's going to do it for Levy's penalty. The Indians and the Jacks at five skaters aside as it's cleared up into the Baltimore players' bench. And we'll have a stoppage of play with 6:24 left second period.
Well, good job for the Indians to get rid of that Baltimore power play now, get things back to even strength, and take a look at it from that point on. We're going to see some of the action right here. Neil Coulter, who the last 2 weeks has been playing outstanding hockey for the Springfield Indians, one hands one right out in front, using his size and strength to his advantage. As you see, the defenseman Dahlquist was riding him out of the play, but Coulter, with one arm on Dahlquist, the other on his stick, still made a good play out of that in the Baltimore zone. Neil Coulter, using his size, speed, and that big slap shot the last 2 weeks, has been very impressive in the Indians lineup.
Planned away, it's cleared by the Jacks into the Springfield zone. And here's Bill Stewart taking over for the Tribe. Here's Stewart for Springfield in this 2-1 game. Ahead into the center ice area, and Hapshine. Left side pass for Hamway. Hamway slides for Hapshine. Centers in front, Hotham. But deflected away. Delayed penalty coming up against Baltimore as they send it down into the Springfield zone. And let's see what this is all about.
Well, this combination of Mark Hapshide, Mark Hemway and Ari Hunpa, once again, the 3H club on the ice for Springfield, doing the job. And we're going to see it right here. They've been one of the most impressive line combinations for Fred Creighton all night long. Hanpa there trying to get away the shot on Heron, but was thwarted from behind on the play. Jim Magoo is in the box for hooking here with 6:03 remaining in this second period. The Indians down by a goal, and Gene Ubriaco last season. This has been a complete turnaround for him. Last year, the Baltimore Skipjacks were riding high in the American Hockey League, but this season, he has been through some violent storms into the Skipjack land all season long.
He went through a 13-game winless streak earlier this season, and he was forced to name a player of the month at a luncheon. Had the difficulty of going through a big streak losing and then having to face the fans and the media at a big luncheon in Baltimore. As play at the left point with the Indians on their third power play chance of the night. Here's Leiter at the point. Slides it through in front for Hapshai, but it hops over his stick. Back behind the net. Here's Hamway for Hapshai. Shoot! And good save by Heron, who had that side of the net covered. Now Leiter for the Indians. Feeds it on the far side. Working in for Springfield is Levy, but tipped away into the center ice area. And Hanpa scampers back after it for the try. Left side for Ken Leiter. Head on the right wing boards, and Hanpa for the Indians. Gets by Steve Carlson. Then it's passed through for Hamway, who shoots right on! And Heron the save. Back to the point. Levy for Leiter. Feeds it through on the far side. Hanpa shot deflected away. Loose in front. And back to the left point where Leiter for the Indians. Cross sides for Levy. To Leiter. Feeds to the side for Hapshai to Leiter, who shoots. Oh, and kicked aside by Heron over the glass on the far side.
Well, Dennis Heron comes up with another beauty. The Indians with some good combination work in the Baltimore zone with 55 seconds remaining on the Magoo penalty. We can take a look at some of it right here. Ken Leiter quarterbacking the play from the point, gets it in from Mark Hapshai. You see Baltimore has all angles covered at that point. Then Hapshai gets it back to Leiter, who one times it, and with some traffic in front, Dennis Heron right there kicks that puck aside and up over the glass into the crowd. For Dennis Heron, a little deja vu in his career, playing with Pittsburgh and then going to Montreal and then ended up back in Pittsburgh. Been back and forth, but Pittsburgh has been a big part of his career.
He also one of the bestowed members of the Kansas City Scouts, where he toiled for a couple of seasons. As it's jammed all the way down into the Springfield end of the rink and out of the net, Casey to clear it on the near side for Ron Handy. Handy is bothered by O'Regan, spins back and tries to get away from O'Regan, who pulls him down right in front of Duhamel. And no penalty called despite the cat calls from the fans on the near side. And Bill Stewart angles it free for Jensen. Cross ice pass to center for Housen. Poke checked at the center ice area and leaves it for Bill Stewart. He comes to center and shoots it off the boards back into the jack into the rink, where Phil Bork picks an opening and winds it all the way down. Just 4 seconds left in the jack penalty as Stewart in his own end of the rink tries to get by Ralston. As Baltimore's Magoo is back on, teams at even strength. The Indians try and work out of their own zone, but tipped away at center by Baltimore and dropped back for their own defense. Now scooped into the center ice area for Magoo with a rolling puck to the near side. Jensen takes a hit, then we're going to have an icing on the play. The faceoff will come back into the Baltimore zone.
Well, March 14th, which is this Friday, the Indians will be taking on the Hershey Bears, and it'll be Hauser Isuzu key night on this night. The first 2,000 fans, 18 years of age and older, receive a car door key. With that car door key, head on down to Hauser Isuzu between March 15th and the 22nd, and if your key is the lucky one and opens up the car door of a 1986 iMark, you win your choice, either $2,000 in cash or a $3,000 discount on 1986 iMark. That's this Friday night. Hauser Isuzu key night, the Indians in Hershey, 7:30. And what would you do in that situation? That you got a choice of $2,000, cold cash, or $3,000 discount off a brand new car? It's a tough choice. I'd like to be able to make that choice.
You've seen my car, so it probably would be the car.
There's nothing wrong with your car. It's the condition of your car.
Right. What I've done to my car. Is that what you're going to say?
Strictly self-imposed.
A play at the point. Leiter just misses on the far side. Jammed up and cleared. Indians try and work it in front, but Tate tries to whack at the loose puck. Now it's jammed to the far side for Tate. Centers one in front, and the Indians, Hauku, is dashing between the circles, couldn't get control of that pass, and the loose puck rolls to center. 3 minutes and 15 seconds left in the second period as Craig Levy slaps one through. In comes Terry Tate. He's bounced off the loose puck. Mad scramble and cleared for Houck, whose shot is blocked, and the Indians Levy has to go back. Up the alley for Ed Lee, but a two-line offside ensues.
3 minutes remaining in the second period, and speaking about this coming Friday, Saturday night, another promotion here at the center. On the 15th, it'll be the Indians and the Rochester Americans. It'll be Big Y night. A lot of things happening on this night. The announcement of the Springfield Indians all-time team. A lot of the fans, you see some of them right there. Maybe a couple of those fans will be the lucky ones, winning some great prizes. Big Y gift certificates to be given away. Indian season tickets and weekend for two, courtesy of Central Travel and US Air. So a lot of things happening. This Saturday night, the Indians in Rochester will have both the announcement of the all-time team and also the lucky winners in the Big Y trivia contest.
You know the answers for those all-time teams, don't
you? Sure do. I sure do.
And you've been mum all year long.
Mum is the word as far as that's concerned. The fans will have to come here on Saturday night and see for themselves.
You won't even tell me.
You might even see some of them in person.
Ooh.
That's a good deal.
That's right. Okay, jammed up to the far side as Hamway centers in front. Hot shot, a shot, oh! Heron able to make this stop, but he falls on top of the loose puck after it almost trickled underneath him.
Boy, Dennis Heron has been the story here tonight. The Indians are doing all they can in the Baltimore zone. Another look at this one. Mark Hamway has the puck for the Tribe, and Ari Hanpa, who has the only Springfield goal after Habshad gets the shot at it right there, looking for the rebound, and actually, it was the stick of Hanpa that upended Heron, and he just fell on that loose puck. There's a look at the veteran, Dennis Heron, an outstanding game to this point with 2:41 remaining second period, and Baltimore on top, 2-1.
Heron had a 2.64 goals against average with the Montreal Canadiens back in 1982 when he led the league in that department. So this guy can play. Jammed up back behind the net where Phil Bourque takes over, clears it on the left wing side, then out to center. Jacks try and work it free on the near boards. The pass for Magoo rolls off his stick. Then he spins it to the left side and fought for and jammed up on the near board. Here the Jacks clearing to the Springfield line as Habshad at center moves into the Baltimore zone, pulls up at the blue line. Shovels it to the far board. Quick shot by the Indians. Paddock, and it deflects in front. And back the other way comes Baltimore. Just over 2 minutes left in this second stanza. On the far board, Jacks try and work it in front, but Paddock stands his man. And lead pass to center for Habshad. Broken up and swatted right back in. Now Paddock in his own zone. The Indians eyes the traffic and feeds for Handy. Deflecting all the way into the Baltimore zone. That's going to be an icing as Dahlquist touches it. Faceoff will come back in the Springfield zone.
Just a minute and 41 remaining in this second period. The Indians down by one, but they could be ahead by at least three if not for the play of Dennis Heron in this hockey game. He's really done the job, and the Indians trying to come back. But once again, we're seeing on this Springfield Indians team plenty of intensity, and it's been there on a consistent basis now for Fred Creighton. He's getting it every night, and that's what you need now with less than a month to go in this season. The Indians, with every game looming large as far as importance is concerned, the intensity level has to be at a high at all times.
Steve Carlson against Ron Handy as it's jammed up and quickly shut on, but Didick takes control in his own zone. Beats the center for Handy as it's bouncing around on the far side and then cleared on the near board for Jensen. On left wing for Johannesson. Beating pass for Handy and on goal, shoots right on. Heron the save. Now it's centered. Here comes Didick in on goal. His shot, he blasts it wide. And the Jacks come back into the center ice area. Here is Baltimore's Colin Chin trying to spin through. Chin feeds it back behind the net for Simpson. Centers, but deflected back behind the goal and tipped on the far side for Jensen with just over a minute remaining in this second period as the Jacks have to hustle back in their own zone. And Wally Weir feeds to center. Now Simpson on left wing, passing it through for Carlson. He's bumped off the puck, and then Levy's able to scoop it on the far side over the glass with just 45 seconds left in the second period.
Well, between periods two and three, we'll be talking with one of hockey's immortals, veteran Gump Worsley, who played for 20 seasons in the National Hockey League, and really the game says it all right there. He's a scout now for the Minnesota North Stars. He'll be our guest between periods two and three.
Very entertaining hockey personality, and I tell you, one of the all-time greats. Face off to the circle to the right of the Indians goal, and John Casey. Play it away at the point. Hopham shot right on. Glove save, Casey. And we'll have another face-off in the Springfield zone with 41 seconds left in the period.
Dangerous situation right now, just 41 seconds remaining, and Baltimore really within striking distance here with the puck in the Springfield zone. The Indians want to win this face-off and get it out of there, because to give up a goal here late in the second period would be a tough situation for the Tribe to come back from. Really could be a demoralizing factor right now, as they're battled all night long, and if Baltimore would score here late in this second period, it would definitely hurt the Tribe.
Planned away, it's tipped to the side of the goal, now centered, jammed up and cleared by Levy, but not out. Hopham winds it in front and on the left wing side. Now quickly cleared through, and the Indians take control. On right wing is Housen. Shooting one, Heron the save, as Housen blasted one as he moved in across that line.
Well, Dennis Heron, who's had a problem with rebounds tonight, did not have one there, as the puck actually got lodged in the pad there of Dennis Heron. Here's Scotty Housen with the blast. Bork is the defender back there for Baltimore. Big slap shot. Terry Tate was bearing down, looking for a rebound opportunity, but there was none, as you see the puck right there in the pad of Dennis Heron. Makes yet another big stop.
Hope you're enjoying the action on Continental Cable Vision. 2-1 the score in favor of the Skipjacks of Baltimore, who currently trail the Indians by 10 points in the division standings. This is a key four-point game, as they call them. Planned away. Here's Houkcheck on the far side. And the Jacks come to center ice. And Carlson scoops one to the Indians' line, where Leiter takes control and feeds into the center ice area. And Housen, long shot, and handled again by Heron. Rebound taken by Hopham, and the buzzer sounds, signaling the end of the second period. And again, the Indians, I think, outshot Baltimore. And despite that fact, still trail 2-1.
Well, despite the fact, and the fact is Dennis Heron so far, 2-1 our score. The Indians one step closer, but now they're going to have to gear it up and come from behind in this one in the third period, because they've been really banging at the door, but they have not yet to find out what the answer is as far as Dennis Heron is concerned. But once again, as we said after the first period, continue to work hard, continue the same style of play. The Indians might work themselves into another victory here tonight. Baltimore seems to be ready to be had, because the Indians have been controlling the play in the Baltimore zone, but 20 minutes left to play. We'll just have to wait and see.
Shots on goal through two, 27-16 Springfield. In that second stanza, the Indians outshot Baltimore 13-10. Gump Worsley will be John's guest in just a moment. We'll be back with more on Springfield Indians Hockey.
Combination that's out of this or any other world. Jacket World, the Pioneer Valley's oldest and largest discount factory outlet of ski wear and outerwear. And Woolrich, top quality manufacturer of stylish warm winter wear. From the top of your head to the tips of your toes.